There have been times where I may have made a mistake which motor over there. There may be times where your homeowner tells you, I don't want the motor over there, I want it over here.
Out of four.
And you have a motor that's designed for over there. You can call and ask us, hey man, I need a right-handed motor. We're going to send you a right-handed motor. This thing right here is a couple thousand bucks. And it costs a shit ton to ship this heavy thing. But this arbor that goes in there only costs maybe $100 or more. It doesn't cost a whole lot to ship. Okay? So I want to show you this real quick, how to change this out. Here. Okay. Yep. So if you ever have to change this from a left to a right, and you can turn a socket, you can do this.
We're going in a little more.
Yeah.
Okay. This guy slides right out.
YouTube.
Okay. This guy slides right off. We're going to send you one of these and two of the other gears right here. It has four Phillips heads. So you're gonna get a new one of these facing the other way and two, this is called a double dog, facing the other way. We're going to reuse these four.
Plus over Allen.
Allen head, yep. Did I say Phillips? I meant to say hex head. You're going to reuse those four screws right there. You're going to replace this shaft, and that is all she wrote. That slides right back in. That slides in, and this slides right back in place. Sometimes when I'm doing an actual motor install, I take this out for half a second. You study that, please? And I'll explain to you why. Here comes with a very specific distance. Your pulley should always go against the back wall. If you put this in and your pulleys are against the front wall, your motor's facing the wrong way. Okay? If your pulleys are right here and you take them apart and put them back in, you've got a gear that's spinning the wrong direction every time. So then we're going to have to replace the shaft. Another reason I leave this out is with this guy in place, I don't have a real skinny self-ratcheting wrench for attaching these nuts right here. And that specific dimension, there it is, this hole and this hole, this little square point right there and this little square point right here are very specific width for dropping this in place when future comes. So if I take this out and tighten these guys up now, I'm good to go. And I don't have to worry about squeezing a small wrench in there, only being able to turn that wrench a little bit because I'm hitting these. I can tighten this up with that out of my way. And it's really not that hard to put this back together. So I'm gonna do that right now. Box is shrunk or grown a little bit. And when we go to hang the box, it's too tight this way or too tight this way. I might actually ream this whole out with a drill bit before I set my key, when I call my keyhole right here. Okay? Without having to adjust this in that way or out that way. And then I'm going to give you guys my socket in this, and I'll let you tighten that up. Thank you.
carry, I take this out so that I'm not fidgeting with these screws and the rope reel getting in the way of the screws, so.
Use the socket.
It was on the power.
and go bam, bam, bam. That's what I like to do. In the field, this right here is my time saver.
Chris, turn it.
I didn't put it together.
There you go. So in the field, I would have done exactly what he did. Realize I made a mistake, change the route. No big deal, right? And then I always do the non-motor end of the cylinder first, because that basically is light, easy, and it holds it up for me down here. It makes it much easier for me to find where my holes are. Bruce, we got food here?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, all right.
You want to let everybody know? Hey, Jerry, you want to let everybody know they should put that together on the concrete, not on the lid?
Yes.
Okay.
I would think in this group of guys, it's enough common sense to know that. Maybe if you will now.
If you don't say it, you never know.
Okay, thank you for pointing that out, Jesse. I would just assume, and you don't have to, when you assume, you make an ass out of you.
Are you and me.
That's how I remember how to spell it. Don't need spell checker for that word.
Nope.
At this point, your pool's got water in it, okay? And it's much easier for me to put this up here for everybody to see than down here.
No, I know.
So, but again, this is something where you might need a socket. I can typically reach in there. Actually, I have to use a socket. So, we want to make sure these are good and snug. One of the things I'd like to point out too on the cylinder, there's a spine to this. We'll get to it in a second here. Here's the spine with your pre-drilled holes. From the factory, they put a little, on the center hole, they put a little line and the letter C so you know where to center it. When I'm building the pool in the field, I take a little marker or ink pen, and I find center, exact center between my tracks here, and I mark it there. So that when I go to drop this in, I can eyeball center and then double check it with my handy dandy speed square. So that when this guy's sitting in the cover pit, I got perfect alignment. So that's nice and tight. Let's set this on the floor for a second, guys, and get it out of the way.
Yeah, you got the mouse
in front of you. Yep. What really made me fall in love with this system? Seem awfully low because you raised up the lid right here.
riser to match the coping. And this goes in the same fashion. This slides in the track. Under track. I should start with the right one first. Alrighty. And when I go out to the job with some of you guys, I like the race you're doing this. Okay? Jesse's never beaten me once at putting those in. Nor will he. Now this guy right here, you know, same thing.
I've been training.
Yep.
I've been training. I'm
20 more years.
Yep.
Me, boss.
Yep. Well, I've been training.
I'm going to let our Aquarius guys put these in. Make sure he's using new teeth. Make sure those in here. Doesn't matter where you have it at this point, okay?
That didn't come out really fast. That didn't come out really fast. Anytime he comes out to our job, Patty takes our boss and goes golfing.
Does he really?
Yeah.
Does he really?
I was putting the work. We can't get nothing out of you. Always helps to put on the cover.
Now, if we had concrete right here, I would take and I would eyeball my motor from my center line, with my cages already on there, and I would align these perfectly so the two guys can just drop this right in. I haven't got that luxury right now. Now, one of the paramount things about dropping the motor and the cylinder in here is I'm always double checking this measurement, okay? And I'll show you what that measurement is if you guys come look over here. I haven't tightened these plates up yet on this side, and I will in a minute. Where?
11:40.
Okay, where's Bruce go?
He just walked out.
Okay. What I'm concerned about is the elevation of this, that they might have changed this bracket because my keyhole doesn't line up to my keyhole. So where's Sam? Terry. Do I have to drop these down? Is that look right to you? Because I don't have a keyhole lined up right there. Want to drop down one notch? Not that I don't trust you, but I'm going to look at that one out there. It should be an older model. So, what I look at measurement-wise is from the stop of this plate to the stop of this plate, it should be somewhere right around 12 inches. Sometimes that's 11 and 7/8, sometimes it's 12 and a quarter because your box, again, varies on how you backfill up against it. And then I double-check this, because that's measured 11 and 7/8, and I measure that, and I'm 12 and a quarter, I'm gonna be pissed. And when I make an adjustment to my cages, I always leave the front tied to that keyhole. I make the adjustment on the back. The reason I do that is I don't want my cylinder sitting in this cover pit at an angle like this or an angle like that. By leaving the front keyhole right here, adjust it and making the measurement to the back, I know that my cylinder is always going to be parallel to this common wall. So if there is any variance in the poly box, always make that adjustment to the back. If your cylinder's out of parallel with this wall, you're going to have a crooked running cover that you're going to be dickering with for the life of that pool. So when someone calls me and tells me that their cover runs crooked, the first thing I come and look at without that lid in place is I take a measurement from this common wall to the front of that shaft.
Okay.
If the shafts aren't the same distance off this wall, something's wrong. I don't care if they're perfectly centered, their box could be a little out of square. So I make sure that it's perfectly parallel to this wall. And if that's the case, then maybe it's their pool that's out of square. And then you can make the according adjustment to it. So, I'm going to leave this as is.
Yeah.
It's all
Well, this is a perfect fit as is.
Nuts in there, it can make a lot of noise.
So, and I like to get these screws started in here before I tighten the bracket. That way there's no alignment issues right or left. So I've already done that side, but I want you to notice that I've tightened this up against this first. I got a little 1/8-inch gap back here. That's why Sam likes to leave his loose and tighten in there, and you can pull this little key out and leave that hole. Because right now, my bracket is set at a perfect 12 inches, but the hanging hardware is at like 12 1/8 or 12 3/16. And another thing I always double check is I like to measure my distance right here to make sure, okay, is that 3 1/2? You know, 3 1/2, so I'm nice and parallel. I do not want this out of kilter in here. So let me snug the backside up. And then, Sam, what do you like to do next? You like to get going on the track, right? So on a long pool, you're going to have two long sections of track. Gary, can you hook a brother up here?
Fabric. Thank you, Wes. There is has a shiny side that goes down and a matted side that goes up. And the ropes are going to come factory wound with a couple green twist ties down there. I always like to unravel them and make sure there's no knots in there. If they got a little doohickey, it's a nice tight pull. We'll get those doohickeys out, okay? And when it comes to feeding this rope, some of you guys end up taping a piece of string on there, like a fish tape. Yeah, it's a much easier way to do it. Get this up on deck for a second. We'll do that pulley there. I take the first two or three feet of rope, and I just muscle it in like that. And while I'm standing on the deck, I keep 1 foot.
You need to go on over there, Bob.
I get a firm grip, and I just walk this through like so. It's a one-person job right here if your rope is untangled. If it's not, you might want someone down there helping you feed it for when you get a little curly.
You guys won this one.
Okay. Oh, we'll beat Jerry all
any day.
So you guys might beat me in this, but this was showed to me a long time ago with my pulley. So I thread this through the pulley down here.
Don't you guys do 100% cover pulls?
99. And all that holds this pulley on.
So you better be, Terry. Process, guys, make sure you clean out your track before you slide all this stuff in there. You want to make sure no pea gravel's in there or concrete burrs from pouring.
And one thing that's really
I can't get it to come my way.
Most of the time it's just dirt I'm cleaning out because our cuts are most of the time I'm cutting it once and it's still too rough.
Did everybody hear that?
But yeah, I know what you're saying. They've got tape on there and that's up really nice. That's a good idea.
If you have a sloppy cut with a gap, if you put a little tape back here, you're not going to have concrete cream oozing in and getting down into your retainer part of the one piece. So, so is our hole line up there, Terry?
Yeah.
Okay. My drill's down there by you guys?
Yeah.
All right.
Jerry's way is right, but in the field, Samuel and I all the time, we walk this track in with the two pieces and put that pin in because to avoid this track moving back.
Exactly.
If you put this pin in, the track will move enough where you can lock your locker in. So now that the pin's in, you can smack this in, you don't have what Jerry's running into.
No, well, that's because it's already, cut and we're a tad longer.
Right, but if you're in the field, you don't have that issue.
So
you're saying once you cut it, fit it, got the rope in, drill your hole, stick your pin in before you put your shims in.
Yep. The first thing I do, period, is put this piece in, drill your hole, I hang this out, I put this long piece in first, hang it out 1.25 inches, drill my hole, then I put my pin in it, and then I measure this short section, a lot less tape measure to hang out.
All right, then I
cut this short section, test fit it, set it on the deck, take this piece out, set it on the deck, splice them together.
So and you work backwards.
And then when Samuel has his mechanism and everything all together, we'll run our ropes, set that back in.
As one whole
length, put my pin in it.
And then all you gotta do is add your rope hardener, your rope guide hardener next.
And then I come and start on this end and knock the track lock all the way in. All the way down and cut it just a little bit short down here.
That's called a shim. And that's a good point, Spencer. You don't ever have to run your shim all the way out to here. If you come up a couple inches short, that'll make it easy for you in the future if you ever had to take the track out. It also doesn't get in the way when you're drilling your hole. These holes do not come drilled. At this point, now we've got our track in, we got our shim, we've got to drill this hole right here for the pin. And it's a good idea to put that one in first. That locks your track to the retainer.
And part of the reason we like to drill these holes first is then when I get ready to run that rope, I can take this thing, drop it down in. These rope guides are sharp. So when you run your rope, now you have no burrs for your rope to grab on that aluminum or take the chance of coming back out. So it's already locked in there. This can slide easy. It can't get bound up. It's got a rounded edge.
So are you putting that on there before you run the rope?
No.
After you run the rope?
I start my rope, like Jerry did, let the 3 feet hang out. Once I've done that, take this piece, just put it on here, and let it set in there, or you can put this pin in. Now I run my rope just so this has a nice place to slide on.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
There's a long Allen wrench on that table there with a handle.
So what you're doing is making the cut end down here and using the factory end down here so you have no burrs on the end in order to... I see, because that's what I see, because if you work it backwards, then we're always filing on this end.
Yep.
So I
want to
show you something with the rope guide.
That's a good, that's a great idea.
Terry's already got his on. It is universal, meaning that piece could go over here or this piece could go over there. And I want to show you what this extra hole is for, because everyone always asks that. There is a little tap that helps you align this perfectly. There are hex nests underneath the top and bottom, so it doesn't matter what side is up. I like to make sure that I got this batter piece in the inside of the pool. If you notice on the track, there's a skinny channel and a large channel. The large channel is meant to take this. This will go in like so, and at this point we can drill our second hole. One of these
the rope guide hardware to the track. The other one attaches the rope guide hardware to itself. I always put the Allen head side up, and the hex, you can feel it underneath with your finger. And with one little finger, you can hold that in and tighten this together, okay? I'm not gonna tighten it just yet, because we're not quite ready, but that would be how I put this together. Anybody know what this extra hole right here is for? What? Magnetic sensor. Back in the day, most of our motors would only stop when a magnet that was inside the webbing of this fabric touched that sensor. Nowadays, this thing stops when this black block hits the hardware inside this. Okay? So I gotta take this
out here. And another thing you can use before you put the magnetic sensor in, you have water feature.
Water feature.
That way they cannot open the cover unless that magnetic sensor is open to where the water feature will take water into an automation.
Does everyone get that? So you got a waterfall on this side of the pool. If you have automation, you can tie the automation in to this simple sensor. Garage speaker wire, garage door opener wire. It'll shut off that actuator when that magnet is not touching that sensor. So as soon as someone goes to close it, shuts their water feature off. They can't flood their cover. Now,
that's good.
Saltwater pools. There's a lot of cover pools with saltwater having problems because you're generating that salty chlorine when the cover is closed. Over-chlorinating your pool, bleaching your liners, burning out your liners, wrinkling your liners. You can now program the Pentair, right Bruce? So that it will generate the chlorine only when your cover's open. So it's gonna elongate the life of your liner and your cover. So we'll get back to that in a second. I wanna set this down. At this point, we've got our rope spec. We've got our rope hardware roughed in and drilled out. So we take it back off, and now we need to get our leading edge bar and our slip dowel on here.
Before you do that, you want to make sure that you want to run your rope across.
Oh, yeah.
It's not in your way while this is back out of the way.
Yep. And I've done that, and I've had to fish it underneath here. So good point, Terry. So what Terry has done is he has taken his opposite end rope and run it through the pulley, and that's going to go through here. Get this out of the way. Okay. And I'm going to feed my pulleys on this one right now while I'm at it. It goes through that pulley, it goes through that pulley, and it's going to go through this pulley. How do I know that, guys? How do I know what pulleys to feed this rope through? Maybe my cylinder is not centered. Maybe my motor's got to go that way a little. As I look at this one, this comes out nice and square. If I notice that the pulley were over here, I'd have to make an adjustment on this threaded rod. If I notice that the pulley were way over here, I could tighten this up and draw it back without, but I want to make sure that this rope comes out of here nice and square, okay? So now we're ready for our leading edge bar. What they've already done for us is they put this on, and this is a slip dowel insert. You have to add these yourself. The way I remember it, I look at the stamp. It says U.S. patent pending or something like that. I want to make sure that this slip dowel has the letters down, and this slip dowel has the letters down, and not flip-flop, okay? The other thing I do is I got to pound this in on the cement. I put a little cardboard underneath, and I stand on this so that I don't scratch the underside up, and I tap that guy in nice and flush. You get one shot at it. You're not going to get that thing out without cracking it, shattering up with channel locks or whatnot. There's another thing to identify the top of this. I love going to jobs and seeing that you guys put this in upside down. This is the bottom. This has a nice profile so that if it does sag, it will come across the wall cap without any problem. If I come out there and see it's upside down and you were in this class, you're getting a swift kick in the behind. Okay? This is our bottom. Yes. The telltale is, thank you, Spencer, they give you a pre-drilled hole here for your fabric. And we're going to sleeve this on in the field, and it's much easier in the field with two guys. Give me a little resistance there. There we go. It's much easier with two guys in the field. Now, on a bigger cover, on a bigger pool, let's say this is a 20-foot pool. Your fabric is something like 20'10", because it's got to allow for about five, maybe it's 21'2" or something. It's got to allow for the fabric to drop. So when you run this across, you're going to have a little bit of fabric hanging out. And they give you a nice little cool piece of hardware, but I don't think I have it here. Do I, Bruce?
The little screw.
The screw cover caps? So at this point, I take that little screw cover and a screw, and I'm going to attach the fabric on one side, right here, right, Sam? I got the thumbs up from Sam, that means I'm doing something right. So I'm going to attach it on one side, and I've got all this excess fabric that we need to gather up across the edge of the leading edge bar. So let me throw that guy in. Okay, and I would cover that with a gray cap so they don't see that shiny thing right there. And at this point, I've probably got 8 inches of fabric hanging out here, and we need to bind this up across the top to divvy the end of that slack up. In this case, I really don't need to do that much. What the heck can I do that? Thank you, Sam. So that attaches your lead edge bar.
Normally you'll have a little plastic cover.
Right, that's right, so I don't have it here. So that's nice, a great cover, covers the screw. Next thing is a slip dowel. Is that the proper term, Bruce? What I've been calling it.
Hey, Jerry, did you want to talk about putting a screw in here?
We will in a second. Yeah, thank you.
So to keep that thing from slipping out.
In the hardware, the little cover comes in, they give you an instruction, a little instruction of two of these extra screws. What has been known to happen over time is these slip dowels will wiggle out with tension. So they like it if you pre-drill a small hole right here and add another stainless screw. That ties your slip dowel to the leading edge bar. It'll never wiggle or drip out of it. guys like the top. Okay? Our rope guides have a hex head. It comes with a screw already attached. I'm going to put that in the middle of the three big fat screws. If I need to adjust my thing forward, I'm going to cheat this like that and put it there. If I need to make a rear adjustment, I'm going to put it there. But factory setting, okay? So if I cut this track too short and I got to pull it this way so I have my inch and a quarter hanging out, I can do that. And I can still make this close tight at that end simply by gaining a half inch right there, okay? It's happened. I can explain to you over the phone how to make that correction if you understand the terminology. The next thing I do is I tighten this down, but I don't hammer this home with a sock or with an impact. Sam, how tight do you tighten these? Stubborn. This has to be able to swivel a little bit like that. So if you over-tighten this and you take that tolerance away, you may have cover adjustments to make too often. Tighten up. Normally the screws I see, I got about three threads showing. This screw's a little shorter, or this bolt's a little shorter. So, who's got the other slip down? There we go. And how do I know which way these go? I don't want this pointed end sticking out towards the shallow end wall. I want the flat end.
Leading edge bar. That cover
At this point, I got 100 extra feet of rope on one of these cables. Maybe 30 or 40 feet.
When they sew the fabric together for a 20 by 40 pool, they don't know if the motor's going there or there. So both your ropes are the same length. One of these is going to be shorter than the other because it's only gone down and back, and the other's gone down, back, and over. At this point, I take my handy-dandy scissors, and I cut these, and I melt the tip. Okay? We plug in here, and I come back with these. And I try to get my knots fairly close. So I'm going to start with a little knot right here. And I try, you know, I don't want one knot here or here. I want my knots fairly close to the tip. Don, what's Don here? Here on? Yeah. Any guys never get so my knots are on here.
Picked up off of the thing.
Jerry, there it is.
You got it? You put it in your pocket.
I had two in my pocket.
I bet you does your dresser have a lot of nuts and bolts on it? And tools?
We got this pot on top of the dryer that's got a ton.
Uh-huh.
So
give these a good snug. Back in the day, instead of this handy little cotter pin, they gave you a third set screw. Now, those were kind of a pain in the butt to work with.
Yep.
So at this point now we can do our handy dandy combo here. Okay?
Yeah. guys hear that? One of the things I do is I lay my fabric out, I measure, I find the center line so it coincides with the center line on the drum. But I don't start there at the center. I start on the outside. What Sandy does is the same thing I do. He looks at his webbing and he lines it up so that it's fairly square coming out. I'm going to reuse their hole there just in a little. So I would have it like that. It's a smaller unit. Okay? I don't ever want the webbing up on the trunk like this.
Why would I not want that?
Every time it winds up, it gets fatter. It might get so fat that it rubs against the box. It rubs against the underside of the lid. So make sure your webbing is hanging off the edge. Okay? So on a big pull, I would start with my outside two. And I'm just going to reuse their hole. Okay? And I would pull this pipe to there on a big pull. They'll show you that in the installation manual. Do the same thing here. Find my center, what my center is, and do my screw nice and flat next to that. And then between the center and the outer edge is where I like to divvy up my slack. Now every pool is a little bit different. So refer to their installation guide for this part. But right now I'm just going to use the holes that they've given me. Okay? Again, it's paramount not to put this too close to the drum. To make a rope adjustment. Does anyone know why that is? Yeah. You set all your rope out in the track, but there's very little here on the reel. So you have an easier time backing this off, right, Sammy? Sammy, which way do I want to move the knot on? Maybe Samuel's my guy. Where are my service guys here?
You don't want to tighten the rope closer to us.
So I want to tighten this one. So does that mean move the knot this way?
Yeah.
Or that way?
That now, way.
All right. Test it.
You want to shorten that rope.
Yep, just a little bit, yep. So another thing I can do to make, let's say your tracks are two different lengths. Let's say this one's 20 foot, and that's 20 foot 1 inch. If I want to make that side go farther, there's a couple things I can do. I can elongate the rope. I can take a scrap piece of rope, I can tape it to the rope reel. What does that do? It changes your gear ratio. It makes the one side of the rope reel fatter, carrying one side out technically faster. So those are some of the little cheater tips out there for you guys. So I'm gonna throw this back in. Another thing I can do, because our guy from Defiance here rolled these ropes up nice and neat, I can roll this up real sloppy, making the rope crisscross itself 3 or 4 times. Because your first four or five feet of rope are on the reel, they're never coming off. So if you only got to gain a little bit on that side or this side, whichever side it is, make the rope crisscross several times while you're doing your initial roll up, instead of having a nice knee roll up. Go ahead and send me out. You got a 1, 2, 3, 4 check in this one. Okay? So I'm still gonna try and roll my ropes up nice and neat here. Okay. We can talk about how to change settings and numbers. Don't make me kill you, Hill. Much better? We're better? All right. And okay. Okay. So we'll leave it. Let's bring it back now. All right, right there's good. So at this point, we like the way our cover's running, and we want to put our lid on. The lid brackets act as a rope guide. We try to leave our ropes going through all these lid brackets, because you're going to have several of them across this back wall. It beats them like hanging off like this, getting wet, dripping down here when they're slack. You know, the rodents don't chew on them when they're up here, but if they're hanging down in the pit, they might. You pick it up sand and grit.
Right underneath.
Okay. Now is when we want to level this, because we got concrete on here. Okay? I want to get to this hardware. Here's a little baggie of it. This is the piece I'm looking for that they didn't give us. Everyone knows what this is used for, right? No? All right, hand me that section of lid, guys. This little guy right here screws in, screws. You put it underneath and drive the two screws down over the top. This little guy right here catches the teeth in there. See how that fits in? That is a lid lock. You want to use that. So when you're putting that lid lock on, your lid has to start right here, and it has to slide into that lid lock. That lid lock is in position. Nobody is lifting up right here. The wind, Sam pointed this out to me because he wanted me to talk about this. When you're building an open area and the wind is whipping across, that wind will want to do that. Your competition is some of those shitty aluminum hinge lids where you screw one track onto the concrete and then leave the hinge on. Those things rattle around. I can't imagine showing you what those homeowners got to put up with. Okay? Hey, Bruce, do you have that little black thing? The little black thing that sleeves in here? Put it over there. thing in my pocket or in my bucket.
Right here.
Neither.
Thank you.
So we're going to snug this guy up.
I don't need that. That's like the most simple thing. But I just wanted it all.
That end that you just slid in, and this slid lock right here, there's absolutely no way that this is covered that doesn't know how to work on it. Okay? And if you had cut your lid to the seam right here, you are not able to use that piece as it's intended. And then you've got to spread out your lid bracket, put a lid bracket right there to hold your dummy lid on. Two rolls of rope. You have to replace
Alex had. Key, Alex key right there. Alright. So, first thing I'm going to do is I'm only going to undo one screw right here.
Back to the guy off.
you have to be very careful driving these screws through this hole. I actually like to pre-drill a pilot hole with a fine drill bit so that when I'm drilling these stainless steel screws through, they don't want to wander out or up. So it's a smart idea to pre-drill these. And if you forget that and you drill one through, you only need two screws and need three holes. So if you do that, try and back it out and use a different hole to pre-drill it. You'll remember from this class that says pre-drill these lots, okay? And then it's just a matter of getting our rope back in, our new rope, trying like hell not to cut it short again. Been there, done that. Okay. Oh yeah, first timers do it all the time. Don't worry. Okay.
It's only $300 worth of ropes. Don't
the
worry.
I need to disconnect this.
Here now, and I pried this way, and come down here, and I see that my heat is now engaged.
tighten these sons of bitches back up. And Mitchell said, take a couple self-casting screws and drive them through the hardware plate right here. Okay? And you tighten everything up. What that does is it ensures that that plate can't drift this way anymore. Now on a new install, I might actually take a couple extra minutes and drill a final hole here, a final hole here, and throw two self-tapping screws into this plate so that I never have to double cross the rest of it down that way. Okay? So that was, these guys here know more files to an auto corner than I've ever experienced. So,
there was something else.